Welcome, Pranjal, to the show.
Thank you, Sachin. Thank you for having me.
Great. So to start with, it's been a COVID time and, you know, everything has come online. So what do you think are the new innovative ways that marketers can really think of, apart from traditional print stuff which goes on? So what could be the new innovative ways?
Starting from the last year, I would say a lot many people have become conscious about e-commerce. So initially, when people used to go in groups or in terms of families to the retail stores to buy their daily needs, now, of course, they cannot go. And again, after a year, the corona cases are on an increase. People have vastly shifted towards e-commerce. So e-commerce is something that I would say that has been on a continuous rise. Also, I would say that established FMCGs and retailers are also seeing a vast shift of people shifting to Amazon, to Flipkart, to other grocery retail platforms such as Big Basket and Grofers. All the retailers would say that although FMCGs, the established ones, have been there, they have seen a kind of decline in the sales that is happening. So it's kind of a bit of demotivating factor for any new product of any established FMCG to enter into the retail segment, or for any new product or any new brand to enter right now, since people are kind of leaving the retail stores and moving towards e-commerce. So I would say even in Zydus, when I'm working right now, it's a product which is completely digital release. It's not found in the retail stores. And with the increase in different occasions, let's say we had Holi, we had Valentine's Day. So people are getting more and more kind of occasions and reasons to go online and check what kind of promotions our brand doing in terms of digital marketing. So definitely e-commerce is the way to go. And I would say that people are becoming more tech savvy. So definitely performance marketing, e-commerce is the way that people would be purchasing their stuff now. Sorry, you're not audible.
So would you recommend the print media, or what would be your thought on it?
So it depends on two things. First, how big your brand is, exactly what your brand objective is. So if I would say, let's say we have a new brand, SebaMed, in the market, right? And they have chosen both ways, to go into digital as well and to go into print media as well. So earlier in the last year, I would say that print media did get a bit of demotivation because there was a humongous lockdown and people couldn't go outside. People were not allowed to drive their cars, or even people who were single-handedly driving their cars, they were questioned a lot. The same restrictions are surfacing again. So print media will never lose completely its aura, I would say, but definitely it has a bit declined because India consists of more of youth as compared to the older generation. And the youth participates more on social media platforms and on digital platforms as compared to the print media. So, and of course, not this year, I would say, but definitely earlier, we had a lot many people canceling their subscriptions of the newspapers that they used to get. After a lot many months, they started that again. So definitely print media will be there, but the kind of aura, or you can say the relevance of print media, has been continuously decreasing in the lives of consumers as they shift more and more digital. And of course, we have WhatsApp. So a lot many people receive any sort of news segment or any sort of new entertainment segment through WhatsApp. So I would say digital is kind of the way to go for. So print media is a bit dicey. Depends on what kind of brand objective we have and where do we stand in our brand marketing.
Yes, to an extent, I think what you are saying, yes, it do matters. What are the brand preferences around it? So rightly, yes, true. So I was going through your profile and I saw a lot of stats around it. So, if you can share, how to work on the consumer insight, because as you are also suggesting, it's about e-commerce and a lot of money is been spent on the digital aspect. So how to work on the consumer insight and the research, one amazing terminology that I saw is there, the persona mapping. So share something more about it.
So again, consumer insights are of two ways. It depends on if you're a new brand or a new product. So then you just get to know that what kind of gap that you're bridging in the market. In those terminologies, you do a survey as well. But as far as I have seen from my previous experiences, survey do play a role in consumer insights, but not as much as directly talking to the consumer does. The second stands for that even if you have an established product in the market, but somehow it's not performing or is it even performing, then you would like to see that where it stands in the market in terms of competitive analysis. And then you do a consumer research again to get to know what your perception of the brand is. So I have been part of both. I have been a part of the first one where you are making a product from the scratch. One of the basic rules of any consumer insight is never to discuss the product that you have in mind, and always make your consumer very at ease, because you do not want to sound as an interrogation. You just want to know about their lives. What happens is that any product or any service that you use will always have a specific time in the duration. So let's say if I wake up at 8 o'clock in the morning and sleep at 11 o'clock in the night. So if I'm using some sort of product, so I'm using some sort of service, that will have a set of time, maybe 2 o'clock in the afternoon or 4 o'clock in the evening. So how do I basically understand what importance does that product play in my life? Or if I am using, let's say, personal care products, if I'm using food products, what kind of food products am I consuming? Then what kind of food products do I have a preference for? So in that case, it's very essential for you to make your end consumer at ease and try to understand their life. Just try to understand and talk as a friend to them. That gives you way more insight as compared to completely making your, let's say, entire consumer insight experience as an interrogation. The second thing that also happens is that, again, when you are an established product in the market, but you just want to know the perception that people have about you, the similar thing happened is that you want to make your consumer at ease. And you just want to understand that what perception do they have right now in the market, and what kind of perception do you want people to think about? And then you see the gap. So one thing that, let's say, happened in sugar-free as well, that a lot many people who consume sugar-free has a perception that it's only meant for the diabetic people. But what perception do we want to make clear in sugar-free is that it's just not meant for diabetic people. Anyone can consume sugar-free because it contains natural ingredients, let's say sugar-free natura, so, or sugar-free gold. And also we have a new product out. So we just want to say that it's just not meant for the diabetic people. Anyone can consume it, because if you want to cut down on the sugar levels that you consume every day, and if you want to, you know, have a guilt-free consumption. Same with sugar-free delight chocolates as well that we have in the market, right? So, and also whenever you are doing consumer insights, when you come to buyer persona, one of the rules that you should always follow is not only getting to know your target consumer, but getting to know your super consumer, I would say. And super consumer is someone who you really deep dive. It's that niche part of your target segment where you just want to know that who are they? What do they consume? Why do they do that? And how do they do that? Once you deep dive, you genuinely get to know the life of that person, and then you're able to map them out in a very stated format. And then you get to know that, okay, this is the person you would like to target, and this is the person you would like to promote your product. So this is how you go about consumer insights, and then, you know, out of that, mapping everything in a single format.
Right, right. So, I mean, just taking cues here. So, can you elaborate a little bit about the super consumer you mentioned? So, what will be the advantage if I am into a mass category and you are taking it to the niche level taking the priorities to the super consumer? So, how it helps basically?
So, okay, if I am saying we're super consumer, normally what happens is for any business, from the past experiences, we have seen that 80% of the sales, 80% of the revenue comes from the 20% of the consumers. Either they are the ones who are very loyal, or either they are the ones who really find the best value for themselves in your product. We would like to target them in order to understand where our maximum revenue is coming, because ultimately for any business which is existing in the market, having revenue is the ultimate goal. So for that, what we do is that once we come into super consumer, we just start asking them different kind of questions, that what do they like in the brand? Like if we have, let's say, Sugar Free as a brand, or we have any sort of a brand. So what do they like about the brand? What do they dislike about it? What do they prefer? So this is something, their likes and dislikes. Also, we get to know about their purchasing decisions. That is, when do they go for their grocery shopping? Where do they consume their grocery shopping from? Is it online? Is it offline? And also genuinely getting to know who are they. So are they into some sort of, as we decide or as we divide, psychographical, like what do they think about it, or demographical, where do they live? What is their age? How much do they earn, and what have been they working on? Also, you get to know what are their goals and their pain points. Ultimately, what really happens is that trying to understand what is the gap that a consumer wants to fill in their lives. That gives you an idea that how can your product prove as a solution provider to that person in achieving their goals and pain points. So that is what you do with a super consumer, getting to know what are their aspirations and what are their goals, what do they like to see themselves, or how do they like to see themselves, let's say after 5 years, after 10 years, and slowly and gradually how our product would, get into their daily lives and how it would prove to be something which is really relevant and important for them. So that is what we mean by super consumer. And that gives you a good amount of segmentation on what kind of people can you target? How can you target them? Because ultimately, if you target those people the correct way, then your 80% of the revenue is done. And of course, 20% of the revenue can come when you target the rest of the consumers. They might be loyal, they might be not loyal, but once you have got a good command on the 20% who bring the 80% of the revenue, more than half of our work is done.
Right. Nicely explained. Perfect. So taking the discussion forward, there of course has to be certain competitive benchmarking. When we talk about go-to-market strategies, and that too, spread across various market. So what are the some standards that we can look forward to while managing this benchmarking?
So in my previous experience as well, I have done 3 kinds of competitive analysis, I would say, and all it depends on is that where in the product life cycle or in the product stage are you. So let's say if you are in the beginning and if you are a new product, or if you are a product which is already there, both of them will have a different kind of a cycle to analyze. So let's say if I take the example of a new product, something similar to which I'm working right now, the competitive analysis that you would do is, one is that you would like to do the category penetration versus the brand awareness. So your category penetration is on the x-axis, your brand awareness is on the y-axis. And then you get to know whether your category belongs in an emerging one or an established one. Similarly with the brand awareness as well, whether you belong to an emerging brand or you belong to an established brand. So if I say Sugar Free as a brand, it's an established brand, but into an emerging category, because Sugar Free is also something that's still kind of making its importance in the market. But when I say Sugar Free Delight chocolates is something that still, compared to the Indian consumers, we prefer more of mithai as compared to chocolate. So if I compare myself with other developed countries like UK or US and all these kind of countries, we still are very low in chocolate consumption. And specifically when we come to dark chocolates or sugar-free chocolates, we are even lower. So your category penetration even becomes lower. And Sugar-Free Delight chocolate is something which is launched in November. So again, the brand awareness is pretty low. Whereas you consider something like P&G, so it's already an established brand. And if you consider something like any good product of P&G, let's say Head & Shoulders, So it's an established, it's the shampoo category is also very much established, plus your brand is also very much established. So it gains the higher position. This is one of the competitor analysis. Second one is the price and benefit one. So your price comes on the x-axis, your benefit comes on the y-axis, and you get to know that what is the price that you are trying to put your product out in the market and what is the benefit that it provides. So this competitive analysis basically gives you the value that you are providing to your end consumer and what is the ROI that they're getting of every bit of their product from the market. So if I have a yogurt or if I have something, any product in the market, which is not well known, and if I, let's say I market at a very high price, there's no point since the brand awareness is pretty low. Or if I see that it's just a normal yogurt with not that much amount of benefits, then of course, I need to be very careful on what price am I pricing it, because Indian consumer, one of the insights is that Indian consumers are very, very price sensitive. And with so many choices in the market, they would not think twice before switching to a product which really gives them the ROI or the value of whatever they buy. So these are the two competitor analysis. The third one comes more later in the stage, which is when you're going towards, let's say, ad making or campaign management. In that, you basically compare yourself with other campaigns of the brand in terms of emotional benefit or functional benefit. So functional benefit stands for just, you know, let's say if I take an example of a perfume or a deodorant. So we know that fog is known for, you know, providing that in a bottle, you have 100 sprays. So that's called functional benefit, where it's making the consumer believe about the ROI that fog gives. Whereas if I talk about Axe doesn't mention it, but Axe has a very different way of communicating its product or its advertising. And it's more towards emotional on how spraying an Axe attracts more ladies or attracts more females. So that's towards more emotional benefit, which comes in the later stage. So these are the three different kinds of competitor analysis we do. There are also many sort of competitor analysis, but it depends on the kind of platform that we are choosing in order to get to our market, be it digital or be it traditional one.
Right, right. So I think when these kind of competitive analysis, if it will be doing up with respect to the product that you are mentioning, I'm sure there must be some conversation around what is happening on the digital platform, about, you mentioned about social listening, then there is another aspect called brand storytelling. So how to map conversion increment through social listening and brand storytelling that it is making an impact?
So all of these metrics, be it social listening, be it brand storytelling, you divided it into three phases, which is namely pre-purchase, purchase, and post-purchase. So every consumer journey is divided into these three aspects. Pre-purchase stands for, you know, whenever we talk about all these aspects, we always talk about consumer funnel. So either you can divide it into consumer funnel into these three ways, or you can always divide it into the AIDA model that is very highly discussed in marketers, that is awareness, interest, desire, and your action. So when you divide this consumer funnel, you always in the pre-purchase or in the awareness stage, you get this social listening. Social listening is something where you talk about what are the people talking about your brands when they're not directly talking about you or they're not directly mentioning you. So as I remember that there was one case study that I read about Taco Bell in US. So Taco Bell in US, Las Vegas, it's very famous for conducting actual weddings inside the Taco Bell restaurant. Because through social listening, what they encountered was that a lot many people after getting married were going to Taco Bell for their first meal as a couple. So what they did was they started conducting weddings inside that Las Vegas restaurant so that, you know, people can have their own experience, completely different experience of having a wedding inside the Taco Bell, not only having first meal, but also wedding. So that we got through social listening. So this all comes through the first phase, which is called the pre-purchase phase, where you're trying to put out awareness, where you're trying to, you know, bridge a gap of telling people to know what your product is all about, what your service is all about. Then you come to the next stage, which is purchase. So in that, basically brand storytelling comes. Brand storytelling can be a part of any sort of, I would say, stage, be it pre-purchase, purchase, or post-purchase. Any product, we have, let's say, a food one, or we have a personal care one, is always communicated the best in terms of story. Because if I tell you a story, you will have a better memory of that particular thing as compared to me just spilling out facts. So if I take an example of, let's say, mayonnaise is also one thing which is very underpenetrated into the Indian market. But what I've been reading is that every time any brand goes about to, you know, tell what mayonnaise is, they normally use two facts. One is educating your customer, plus with a pinch of storytelling. With the story, you will always remember how you consume that, and educating your customer, because a lot many people do not know about how to consume mayonnaise. They might be like, you're using it with French fries, or you are using it in a bread or something. But how can you make your customer experience stand out in the best possible manner? That you are doing in the form of storytelling. And finally, post-purchase as well. So once you are done with purchasing our product, then how do we keep on following with the loyal customers? Be it through newsletters, be it through continuous following up emails, or be it through providing promotions. Everything will have a sort of story in it. Especially, let's say, if I talk about newsletters. So it will be like, you purchased this sort of product with us earlier month, and now you can purchase this new product that we have launched. It might be beneficial for you. And why it might be beneficial for you is explained in terms of storytelling. So that is how it kind of builds up into an entire consumer funnel or a journey.
That's right. I think this do affects the whole aspect of creating the next level of communication around also.
Yes.
Right. Great. So, Pranjal, there have been 5 P's generally that we generally discuss in marketing. It's about product, pricing, placement, promotion, and packaging. Now, I think let's take the two part only, placement and packaging. So if you can put a brief focus on how to do it very effectively, because product we have already developed, promotion is already going on, placement and the packaging is gaining attention. So your thoughts on it.
So placement normally comes under trade marketing, and having worked in the retail segments as well, I would say placement really matters in terms of your visibility. So if you have placed your product in the front, or what really happens is, let's say if you have a very important product, or if you have a product which normally you can forget about when you are purchasing in the retail stores. So what happens is those small products are placed on the cash counters or counter tills. So once you are waiting in the line to get your self-billed, or, to finally purchase the products that you have done, that you've put it in a cart, just your wandering eyes kind of give you an idea, okay, this is something that I'm forgetting. So I might also add it into the my cart. So that is one place on how the retail stores really increase their average order value. So let's say if I have working in the fashion environment, I would also say that how do we used to increase average order value was by keeping all these accessories, or let's say shoes or something like this, near the cash counter tills, so that if the ultimate goal of the people were to buy some clothes or just an attire, they would complete it by buying those accessories. And also we also complete our goal of increasing the average order value of every receipt or every purchase that happens. So that's how your placement really matters, on how much is it visible. And let's say if you have a new product which is not visible, so how you come with very relevant trade marketing promotions to make your product more visible, and to make your product more desirable by the consumer, so that when they see that, or when that impulse purchase thing comes in their mind, they're able to just pick your product up from the store, or pick your product from the cart and just put it inside the cart. Next comes for packaging. Now, packaging, we always have to remember that whatever is the packaging, your end consumer is the happiest by buying your product. And by the end consumer over here, I mean not only the consumer who is buying your product, that means as a family member or anyone, But yeah, end consumer also includes all the people from the retailers to the wholesalers to the distributors. Because ultimately what happens is that if retailers and distributors are happy with their product, if they do not have any problem in stocking your product, if they do not have any problem in maintaining your product, then definitely your product will reach from the wholesalers to the retailers and finally to the consumer's home in a good format. And you know, the entire experience becomes really good for all of them. So the recent article also that I wrote was that usually with parachute oil, it used to happen that the tin cans were the ones initially which was thought as packaging, but ultimately they moved to plastic, but in a square shape. What happened was that because rats used to love the combination of coconut oil and, you know, square, because they usually used to get hand over them, parachute was losing a lot of their material and a lot of their sales, because ultimately never used to reach the end consumer, because everything used to get destroyed in the either the wholesalers or through the retailers. So they had to change their entire packaging into a bottle shape, so that the rats couldn't climb that bottle, and also you are able to sell the coconut oil in a good format. So that's how packaging really matters, that you're not able to only make your end consumers happy, but all the consumers who fall into the line to get to your end consumer. So yeah, that is for packaging. And of course, we discussed about the promotion and placement.
That's so nicely explained, Pranjal, about the parachute example that you took. Perfect. So I think taking the discussion forward, let's discuss more about marketing in community and, you know, collaborations and community management platforms. How effective you feel they are, and how it can be utilized for a better purpose?
When it comes to community, I would feel that it really matters how authentic you are. So we have continuously seen the increase in influencers. And of course, a lot many brands are also reaching out to a lot many influencers to get their brand awareness, to get their conversions done. So ultimately, first of all, it matters on what your brand objective is. Is it to increase more brand awareness, or is it to have more amount of engagement? Then of course, you target those kind of influencers who have a huge amount of following, because you just want to put your product across. If it's more lead, then of course you go for the micro influencers. But even in these both stages, I would say that authenticity really matters. And for whatever or whoever influencer you choose, you really have to see that, do they really match the brand value that you stand for? So of course, even in my previous experiences, be it through Zydus or be it through other startups or companies that I work for, we have always targeted influencers. And we have kind of learned it the hard way that we really need to target all those influencers who really share the same kind of brand value. Because if I see some sort of influencers who's promoting everything in the portfolio, from shampoos to chocolates to everything, I would say that that kind of an influencer would not turn out to be good for us in the short run, forget about long run. Because the end consumer also sometimes has a perception that the influencers are very much heavily paid to, you know, increase the brand awareness or to just promote the products. So until and unless the end consumer really promotes the product, because they really feel that our product makes some sort of relevance in their lives or some sort of change in their lives, then we kind of get an attachment that yes, this might be the right kind of influencer for us to promote our brand. So that is how I feel that yes, community and influencers are increasing. Only the thing we have to keep in mind is the authenticity and the brand value that we share across.
Perfect. Great. So taking the discussions towards end, this question is around marketing communication. So what is your take on how to prepare in a smart way?
Marketing communication, like I told you when we were discussing about consumer journey, one thing we always have to keep in mind is that what are your consumer touch points, and always your brand tonality, your brand equity is always maintained in those consumer touch points. So even if you do some sort of different kind of promotions, brand building always happens in the longer term. So let's say even if we have some sort of promotions, we are giving 1+1 free or 2+2 or some kind of these things. you always have to maintain by sight that there's a brand that we are building for a longer run. And there's some sort of a perception that we are building in the minds of a consumer for a longer period of time. So let's say when I talk about cleaning, let's say bathroom cleaning or something like this, Harpic or Domex, something which always comes to our mind. Or when we talk about search, right? So Google is something which always comes the first thing into our mind. And Google has made its place so good in our minds that now it has been started using as a verb. So same thing really happens that whenever you are kind of putting out a marketing communication, always see that your brand tonality matches with what your brand building is there for long term and what your brand stands for. Because you do not want to jeopardize any sort of longer term communication just for a very short term gain. So that is what I would suggest for any brand communication.
That's perfectly managed. So finally, coming to the last question, which is about us, the marketing soul. So we are building a community of passionate marketers to learn, network and grow. So what is your take on it?
It's an amazing platform. I have been through the website and I've been through different areas in the marketing soul. And definitely as the penetration of digital is increasing, not only through Instagram and other platforms, it's a very good area for us to know more about different terminologies that we might not be introduced to. And of course, networking is now the soul of everything, be it to increase your knowledge, be it to get a job, or be it to just be relevant in the market that you want. So marketing soul is doing a wonderful job. And I really wish you the best for your future endeavors.
That's perfect. So finally, this brings us to the end of this conversation with the fireside round. And you have to answer it in only in the one word.
Sure.
Right. So the first one goes with, who am I?
A brand marketer.
Okay. Your current state of mind?
Happy.
Okay. And you are in love with?
Netflix shows and music albums.
Okay. So one thing, without it, you cannot live.
Music, definitely music.
Oh, okay. And what kind of?
I normally listen to international artists. So I have a lot of them in my mind. So currently, I'm listening to The Weeknd, but yeah, I just keep on listening to a lot of people.
Okay, great. So, and your recommendation to the girls starting their career in marketing?
Learn to sell, how to sell yourself, I would say. Selling is one of the key areas which come handy every time in your life, from the starting to the end. So if you know how to sell yourself, be it for a job interview, be it in a market or be it anywhere, and you know, be confident about who you are, and if you believe in yourself, then of course I think you can achieve everything. So definitely learn to sell yourself and be confident in who you are.
Perfect. So that is the perfect ending of this show. Thank you so much, Pranjal, for joining us and sharing your wisdom of knowledge with a lot of examples and case studies. I'm sure it's going to help the community taking the things forward for learning as our agenda goes with Marketing Soul. So thank you so much once again for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me. It was a pleasure.